morning, everyone. I am Lika Lazo. It is 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines. The Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development sharply lowers its global growth forecast for 2022, citing Russia's invasion of Ukraine. The Wall Street falls as the 10-year Treasury yield climbs to 3%. Asian shares set for a mixed start. Here at home, the PSE index extends gains to a second straight day, kicking off from 67.69. Robert Ramos of RCBC joins us for his market outlook. And transport regulators approve a 1 peso fare hike for public utility vehicles, jeepneys rather, as oil prices continue to rise. Business news now. After the World Bank, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, sharply lowers its global growth forecast for 2022. The OECD sees the global economy growing 3% this year, down from its 4.5% estimate back in December. It also downgraded its forecast for next year from a 3.2% expansion to just 2.8%. The main culprit, Russia's invasion of Ukraine.
The economic outlook we are presenting to you today is much more pessimistic than some months ago. Russia's war is indeed imposing a heavy price on the global economy. Global growth will be substantially lower with higher and more persistent inflation. Projections for consumer price inflation have been revised significantly upwards. We project inflation in 2022 to average 8.8% across the OECD before receding slowly in 2023 as supply chain and commodity price pressures wane and monetary policy measures continue to take effect.
The OECD adds the extent to which growth will be lower and inflation will be higher will ultimately depend on how the war evolves. But it says it is clear poorest nations will be hit the hardest. A look now at the financial markets. Wall Street snapped its two-day winning streak Wednesday as investors monitored signs of a potential economic slowdown and kept an eye on the bond market. The S&P 500 led losses, falling over 1%. The Dow shed 269 points, while the Nasdaq dropped 0.7%. Action in the bond market may have hurt sentiment after the 10-year Treasury yield jumped back above 3%. That level is deemed dangerous by market players for investments and the economy, finding worries about inflation and the outlook for interest rates. Meanwhile, oil prices jumped to a 13-week high as U.S. demand for gasoline kept rising. Brent crude oil prices rose above $123 a barrel, while U.S. crude hit $122 a barrel. Markets are looking ahead to May's Consumer Price Index reading on Friday. That print will likely be influential in the scale and speed of the Federal Reserve's monetary tightening path. Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all the major indices point to a muted open when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Over here in Asia, stocks are struggling for direction as investors weigh the impact of high inflation. Australia's ASX 200 leading the decline, down about 0.7%. South Korea's KOSPI index is also in the red. But so far, Japan's Nikkei 225 is bucking the slide, up 0.2% in early trade. Here at home, transport regulators have approved a 1 peso fare hike for public utility jeepneys, effective today, June 9. This is in response to a petition filed by transport groups amid the unabated rise in fuel prices. The fare increase will bring the base fare, or the first 4 kilometers, to 10 pesos. The fare hike is limited to the National Capital Region, as well as regions 3 and 4. Discounts will still be given to persons with disability, senior citizens, and students. Meanwhile, the regulatory board will hear a separate petition to increase the base fare by 5 pesos on June 28, the last week of the Duterte administration. Motorists again call on the Philippine government to suspend the excise tax on fuel as oil prices continue to rise. We have more from Alvin El Chico.
As fuel prices rose, worker Janel has started to use his bicycle and decided to temporarily retire his motorcycle to minimize expenses.
Tambay muna sa bahay kasi mahal yung gasolina ngayon eh. Mahirap yung buhay. Yung dati kasi magkano lang yun, nasa 50 lang yun eh, 53. Ngayon, kuwan na, tumaas na ngayon. Magkano na ngayon ng 78 na ngayon. Mahirap ang buhay.
Gasoline now retails at 74 to 97 pesos per liter, while diesel is at 75 pesos to 90 pesos in Metro Manila. Bayan patrollers have also sent fuel prices in their areas where fuel now costs more than 80 pesos per liter. In Palawan, prices are now more than 90 pesos per liter. Motorists are asking the government to consider suspending the excise tax on petroleum.
Sana iano nila yung excise tax ng petrolyo para kahit paano matulungan yung mga katulad naming motorista.
Kung makakatulong sa pangkalahatan, okay lang po.
Mas okay po yung tanggalin muna yung tax para habang wala pa, at least mababa yung konsumo ng namin.
Removing excise tax means a slash of 10 pesos per liter for gasoline, 6 pesos for diesel, and 5 pesos for kerosene. If government decides to suspend the biofuels component of fuel, gasoline will be cheaper by 3 to 4 pesos per liter and diesel by 1 to 2 pesos per liter. But incoming Senate Ways and Means Committee Chairman Sherwin Gatchalian says it is better to increase the targeted help to the transport sector.
Kahit doblehin pa natin yan to about 6 billion, mas mura pa rin siya kaysa mawala yung 200 billion plus. No? So para sa akin, yan ang mas epesyente pa. Pero hindi ko rin sinasara yung isip ko sa pagtatanggal ng excise tax, Alvin, lalo na kung humaba itong gera.
Gatchalian is not in favor of raising income tax but is studying the possibility of raising taxes on non-essential goods and services. The senator says the BIR should resolve collection efficiency issues, but when asked if the tax bureau should collect the tax on the Marcos estate, Gatchalian insists the issue is political.
Political ploy nga yung narrative na yun eh, no? Lumabas lang nung politika eh. Obviously, politika, story ang politika at pang-politika lang yun. Makikita ko natin, lumabas pa yan sa mga katunggaling kandidato. No? At kung mayroong ganyan nga, dapat lumabas sa bibig ng BIR yan, lumabas sa bibig ng DOF.
Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez earlier said the government is bent on collecting any tax due on the Marcos estate. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
A group of transport advocates urges the incoming Marcos administration to appoint transportation officials who have genuine concern for Filipinos. Alt Mobility PH says the country needs leaders who will break the cycle of focusing on projects that only benefit owners of private vehicles while overlooking the needs of commuters, pedestrians, and cyclists. It adds, officials should swiftly respond to issues hounding the transport sector, including rise in oil prices. The group also calls for better transport policies and better public transportation facilities in the Philippines. The world's largest cryptocurrency exchange, Binance, eyeing to expand its presence in the Philippines. As Jackie Pascual tells us, the company's move comes amid controversies it faces abroad.
The CEO of Binance, Changpeng Zhao, known in the cryptocurrency world as CZ, is in the Philippines to lay down his plans for the expansion of his company's presence in the country. Binance, considered the world's largest cryptocurrency exchange, is planning to get licenses here, particularly the virtual asset service providers, or VASP, and the electronic money issuer, or EMI.
Well, Philippines is very important. It's a short answer. It's actually super important for us. Philippines is more advanced in terms of payment services, mobile penetration, so smartphone adoption, and tech talent, and understanding of crypto.
He also plans to buy or invest into a bank or financial institution in the country. Globally, he is also seeking to invest in different sectors.
We are also interested in investing in traditional financial service sectors, including payment service providers, banks, etc. They have different licenses. And we want to help bring those businesses into the blockchain world.
Binance has been one of the leaders in the crypto space, and it is not spared from controversies. Reuters reported that Binance processed transactions totaling at least $2.35 billion from investment fraud, hacks, and illegal drug sales. Bloomberg also reported the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission is investigating whether Binance broke rules selling digital tokens. But Zhao denies the allegations.
We were very frustrated with the fact that they just reported on rumors and they didn't provide any supporting evidence.
He assures the public that Binance is safe and not involved in illegal acts. He also hopes to work with regulators, saying regulation will actually help spread crypto adoption further. The Banco Central ng Pilipinas has 19 firms with VASP licenses. One of them is Rebitans, which said crypto players are investing in the Philippines because of the huge potential of the country and better regulation from BSP. Zhao now hopes for regulatory and banking support in the Philippines, where he also eyes to hire more Filipinos. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Russia rejects suggestions grain stuck in Ukrainian ports was fueling a global food crisis. Moscow's invasion of Ukraine has not only devastated farmlands, but also disrupted crucial deliveries. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky said on Monday about 20 to 25 million tons of grain were currently blocked in Ukrainian ports that could grow to 70 to 75 million tons in the autumn. The Kremlin disputes that figure, saying the grain reserves are being exaggerated and are too small to have an impact. Russia has repeatedly denied blocking the passage of cargo ships loaded with Ukrainian grain, instead blaming Western sanctions for contributing to the food crisis. Russia and Ukraine produce 30% of the global wheat supply. The Biden administration looking to reconfigure tariffs on Chinese imports. U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen told the House Ways and Means Committee they were examining changes to the Section 301 tariffs on Chinese goods and to the process for product-specific exclusions from those duties. The Trump-era tariffs of up to 25% cover hundreds of billions of dollars worth of Chinese imports, including many consumer goods from bicycles to Bluetooth devices and apparel. But Yellen warned such cuts would not be a panacea for easing high inflations. She believes while some tariff cuts may be warranted and could help bring down some consumer prices, it would have a limited effect on high overall inflation rates of about 8% on an annual basis. Now, here are some economic events we're monitoring this Thursday. Indonesia will release its May consumer confidence numbers. Indonesia's consumer confidence index increased to 113.1 in April from 111 in the previous month as sentiment on the current economic conditions and jobs availability improved due to easing COVID-19 restrictions and increasing vaccinations. Malaysia will come out with its April jobs figures. The unemployment rate in Malaysia declined to 4.1% in March from 4.7% in the same month a year earlier as the economy recovered from coronavirus disruptions. And the European Central Bank will announce its latest policy decision. Investment banks believe last week's Eurozone inflation print, which came in far higher than expected at 8.1%, was confirmation that the ECB would deliver a minimum of 150 basis point rate hike by year end. A supermarket association expects further prices increases in grocery items this month. This includes canned sardine brands, evaporated milk, and cooking oil. For more on this, we are actually joined by Stephen Kua, the president of the Philippine Amalgamated Supermarket Association. Good morning, Sir Stephen, and thank you so much for joining the program.
Morning, Rica. Hi.
Hi, it's so nice to actually see you on a different platform this time. Moving on, first, you have always been talking about the possible increases of price, not just on basic commodities, but also on a lot more. Actually thinking about it going up and down in the next few days, even in the next few weeks. But before we talk about that, I'd like to see the groundwork of the differences, please, on consumer buying patterns. One, first during the height of the pandemic, and now on the rising inflation cases. If you can give us a quick outlook on this, please.
Okay, the difference between consumer behavior during the pandemic, immediately when it came in, there was panic buying. People had money, and they were able to save a bit. No, they didn't expect it, but you know, since they had money, they went out, finished off everything on the shelf, no? Mm-hmm. Whatever brand of alcohol, whatever brand of masks, gloves, anything that had to do with health protocol, no? But this time, after 2 years, and people, some of them lost their stable, regular income, no? Monthly income, medyo nahirapan, no? The people didn't know what to do, and they're just trying to scrounge, trying to make ends meet, trying to stretch the peso, the power of the peso, no? Purchasing power, and then looking for goods which suit their budget, not their needs anymore.
Yes. The LTFRB actually gave a price increase, 1 peso price increase for here in Manila. So that's going to add another effect on the spending of the Filipinos here in the capital region. Do you think, sir, that this, even if it's just a price increase of a single peso, this can affect greatly the buying process, the buying capacity of our locals in Metro Manila?
It will, no? It has an impact, and it's strong, you know, it has a strong impact on those daily wage earners, no? Gasoline went up, doubled its price, no? And diesel, 86% increase, no? So for those who are driving, the impact is great. For those who are commuting, you know, the 1 peso thing is heavy on their budget, no? And then there's tuition or school supplies coming up in the next 2 months, right? So all of these will add up, no? Plus, I don't see prices easing off, no? Or, you know, staying stable where they are, no? For the next few months, since, you know, January, since end of last year, prices have been going up because manufacturers have kept their prices for the last 2 years or so during the pandemic. There was no demand, no way for them to increase prices, even though they needed to increase prices.
But actually, Sir Steven, now we're seeing manufacturing costs possibly even going up. So with this, are we expecting consumer goods prices to even go higher than expected?
I'm afraid we might be seeing that. No, and we're hoping this won't be a runaway inflation leading to hyperinflation. Wag naman sana during the 80s, no, and then stagflation, no, which is the worst. No, prices are going up. Income is, you know, steady or even, you know, has decreased for the buying public.
World economic growth forecast even dropped to, I think, 2.9% for the whole global economic recovery. So we're seeing that it's not just us, it's even first world countries being affected by this. So plans of the government to find alternative sources, even for wheat, like what you mentioned in several programs. I was actually thinking, if supermarket owners or grocery store owners are actually looking for alternative products to sell, at least maybe when we look at it like this, instead of meat products, are supermarkets carrying plant-based proteins? And if they do, do we see patronage of customers purchasing that?
Okay. For those who cater to the prime market, the AB market, no, you can do that because budget or price is not a real problem. Okay, but if you cater to the masses, which is the majority of the market, you're looking for new products. That's true, but you're also looking for the substitutes, which are hopefully more affordable. So it's not, you know, if it's healthy product, but a bit more expensive, the masses can't afford that. So you're looking for, if it's healthy and cheaper, why not? The best, no? But we're hoping that manufacturers will come out with more of the bundling and promotion packs, no? Let's say buy three, take one free, of their slow-moving items, no? Since demand is low, they might as well push out these products right now and give buyers an alternative, no? in terms of prices, no? Kasi, you know, there's still products which haven't gone up. Not everything has gone up, but it's a bit more difficult. You have to look for, you know, needle in the haystack. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I do remember, Sir Stephen, you mentioned before on a different program when we've been able to interview you, that you said these kind of deals where consumers can get another free product are actually dictated by the manufacturers and not the grocery store owners. So I would want to touch on one topic regarding the targeted promotions and loyalty program benefits that some supermarkets and grocery stores offer. Yeah. Do you think that maybe supermarket owners can shell out more of this or at least tweak the existing offers to add a little more for the consumers?
It works both ways. A lot of times the initiative comes from the manufacturers or the distributors. Remember, there's a distributor in between, okay? If they are overstocked with certain goods which are slow moving, then, you know, instead of taking them back from the supermarkets, they will just ask the manufacturers, can we just offer this to the supermarkets so that they can push out these items? Or if, for example, they're changing packaging, they're changing size. So there are many reasons, no? Not just the expiration dates, no? Or slow moving, no? Sometimes they're changing their packaging, no? And sometimes this is an initiative coming from the mother, the parent company abroad, right? Or it can come from the supermarkets. We can tell the distributors, look, these items, your new items are not selling that well. Maybe you'd like to, you know, make a promotion on it so we can push them out quickly and your production won't be stuck up with over, you know, won't be overstocked with these items, no? So they can decide whether to continue with these new variants or stop production, right? See? So it can come from both ways. Now, sometimes it's from the manufacturer, sometimes from the distributor, and sometimes from the retailer.
Mm-hmm. So that's something we have to cross our fingers, please, for something to happen. More good things for the consumers. Looking more at the supply chain disruption, we're seeing issues in Ukraine because of the Ukraine-Russia war. We're seeing disruptions in the China's supply chain. This is, of course, going to be greatly affecting us. Do you think that it's time, because we're already changing government in the process of transition, do you think, Sir Stephen, that it's time that the new government or at least the private sector look into making innovations in food and agriculture sector?
Yes, I've always been saying that there's an over-reliance on imported raw materials, on imported goods. That's why some of the items which have gone up, really shot up in prices by around 20-30%, are those I always say that every 6 years we're starting a new republic. It's about time we continue on with projects which develop industries. So there's no over-reliance on imported goods. You can see that some of the countries just stop exporting their goods because their countries would need it. We don't have that option. Especially for our dairy products, almost everything is imported. Now, all the raw materials for powdered milk, liquid, evaporated, they're all imported. So, you know, we're at the mercy of traders, we're at the mercy of shipping lines, we're at the mercy of people who produce these products, these raw materials from abroad, no? Because we don't have an option. That part of these raw materials come from our own, you know, agricultural industries, no? Yeah, agri-industries.
We're actually a country that is dependent, somehow dependent on the imports that we need, because as you mentioned, we are not capable of producing that agriculturally. But we are also in a time where agricultural protectionism is also being placed by some countries in their important sources. So we're already going to be lacking on important produce materials, raw materials that we need. Do you think that the government, or at least the farmers, the first line producers, have enough, even on the meat sector, to sustain what we need?
The people in the agribusiness, which I'm also involved with, tell me that they have supplies, they have stock. Sometimes the commercial sector, restaurants, eateries, no, they're just afraid that items from the local sector are not stable. But, you know, I guess the government has to step in to make sure that the farm produce gets to the business sector in a way that that's going to be benefiting the business sector too, so that they don't have to import these goods. Because sometimes they find that imported goods are more stable in terms of price and quality. See? So government has to step in because businesses, farmers want to sell their produce locally, but a lot of them go to waste, and that's a real waste. No? You got, you got the solution here, you got the solution here, but you know, you're looking somewhere else. That's why it's a lose-lose situation.
That's why the reason why I ask this, Sir Stephen, is because I would also want to know if supermarket chain owners also look into, instead of purchasing from big names, manufacturers who are already big players in the business, are supermarket chain owners also looking to maybe purchase from the smaller players?
Oh, we do, we do, we do. I mean, the bigger chains, of course, they make it stiffer for suppliers to get in the market. Number one, they have a lot of stores. 200 plus stores can you supply? Just 100 plus stores? No, you can't. So, you know, they don't consider you, no, as a supplier, no, as a qualified supplier. So the smaller chains, we do look at smaller players. We'd like to carry different items in our supermarkets, those not carried by other supermarkets. Otherwise, it's all the same, right? There's no competitive edge. There's no, you're not excited by any supermarket because you enter each one, it's all the same, right? Same, same. So we're looking for unique, you know, product and marketing proposals, no, which we can offer customers. All supermarkets do that.
Fuel prices are on the rise. We're having problems with that as well. So, of course, the import—not importation, but the movement of goods within the country will also affect that. Is there a way for supermarket owners or restaurant owners to cut the middlemen in the process, in the supply chain process, so at least there would be a win-win on the side of the producers and the consumers?
I'm sorry. You were saying that.
If we can cut the middlemen in the supply chain process, just so the prices can even go a little lower for the consumers, is it possible? Is there a way for restaurant owners, grocery owners, to do that, to go first to the first base producers?
There have been many attempts, and it's a continuous process. Now people have been doing that, trying to cut down on the middlemen. No, because sometimes it's the middlemen who are, you know, raking it in terms of profits. No, however, you know, that's why DA, Department of Agriculture, has AMAS. That's an agency under their the department, which that's their purpose. No, the objective of that agency, no, is to connect the producer, agri.
If you can, Sir Stephen, I think your Zoom must have fluctuated. It's muted now. There you go. If you can repeat the last few you said again, please.
Yeah, I'm sorry. The next station is calling me already. That's why.
I'm sorry. I'll make it quick.
Sure.
Okay, if you can wrap it up.
Yeah, but there'll be many attempts. But that is the solution. That you're correct. That is the solution. If we can cut down on the chain, right?
All right, last one before I let you go.
There have been
attempts to at least try to boost online shopping, online grocery shopping. Has this made an impact on consumer spending? And is this a way for consumers to spend less?
Which one? Online? You're talking online?
Online grocery shopping, yes.
Lately, a major online business has added certain costs, which I think have made people wary of buying online. No? But as the market opens, alert levels have been eased. No, people want to go out and buy physically. So there are people who are still buying online, of course, but. I guess the growth of online might be stunted by this easing of alert levels, and where people can now go out and increase foot traffic inside the retail outlets and malls. So we don't know what's going to happen as we ease alert levels. No, we're hoping that both will grow, online and offline shopping.
All right. With that, I will let you go, Sir Stephen. It seems you're going to be having a busy day today. Thank you so much for your time, sir, for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Have a great day. Bye.
Thank you. You too. Always a pleasure talking to Sir Stephen Kuwa, the president of the Philippine Amalgamated Supermarket Association. Up next, a look at the opening numbers of the Philippine Stock Exchange with Rob Ramos of RCBC Market Edge. We'll be right back. You're still watching Market Edge. Looking back at the headlines, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development sharply lowers its global growth forecast for 2022, citing Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Wall Street falls as the 10-year Treasury yield climbs to 3%. Asian shares trading mixed this morning. Here at home, the PSE index extends gains to a second straight day, kicking off from 67.69. And Robert Ramos of RCBC joins us for his market outlook. Finally, transport regulators approve a 1 peso fare hike for public utility jeepneys as oil prices continue to rise. The Philippine Stock Exchange opens higher at 67.96, up 0.4% from Wednesday's close of 67.69. Joining us today for his take on the market, we have Robert Ramos of RCBC. Robert, thank you so much for joining the program.
Good morning, Rika. Great to be here.
All right, let's begin with the market outlook first. The Asian shares are looking mixed. Most of the major indices are actually on the low. Australia, we're talking also about South Korea. Japan is still in the greens, but the Philippines is fluctuating the second straight day. And right now, I think we're in the greens. But do you see this happening in the next few days that we can maintain the numbers?
I think the value of the index will probably oscillate at this point. The major point of concern is rising inflation caused by, of course, what's happening in Russia and Ukraine. As long as that continues, as long as there are concerns regarding global inflation, the stock markets across the globe will behave as such.
So something that we not really are looking forward to. Looking at what's going to happen in the government right now, we're in the middle of a transition between two administrations. Do you think that the index, the PSEI, is in consolidation mode at the moment? Is the market set up for a rally post-inauguration of President-elect Bongbong Marcos Jr.? What do you think about this, sir?
Usually I would say yes. History has shown that markets are usually on the uptrend when it welcomes a new Philippine president. At the same time, the expertise and the experience of his incoming economic team also provides a strong sense of security to both local and foreign markets. However, there are, as I said, a lot of global factors that may impede this. The largest factor is the rising global inflation brought about by the current situation in Russia and the Ukraine. This, coupled with the reopening of a number of markets, have moved inflation to levels which global central banks are trying very, very hard to manage.
Robert, it's not just businessmen here in the Philippines, but also those around the world, foreign investors, are looking at how the new president will form his economic team. And now that he has placed experienced players as part of his economic team, what do you think are the factors we can consider moving forward with regard to the economy of the Philippines?
I think obviously in terms of the economy, it's all about making sure we collect fees, we are able to collect revenue so that the government can spend, and we are more efficient. I think in terms of the track record of the people now leading the economic team, first off, you have current BSP Governor Ben Diokno, now incoming Secretary Ben Diokno. That is, you know, a good start.
Yeah.
You have incoming Governor Felipe Medalla. You have a new NEDA secretary. That whole team is a wealth of knowledge and a wealth of experience. Well, that in itself gives a lot of comfort. Outside looking at, you're looking at global market, you're looking at foreign investors. They see that as a sense of people who absolutely know how to do the job. They have experience and they have learned from their previous years, and they will just, you know, not have to claw their way through. They have, as of this point, they already have plans how to push the economy forward. I think that's how they would see it.
Do you think it's still going to be the same? Because right now we're in a very crucial position in the economy. We can't even say that we're already economically recovering, you know, because the market is fluctuating. The peso-dollar exchange rate is still in limbo. with the solid economic team of incoming President-elect Bongbong Marcos, do you think it gives local and foreign investors at least a sense of calm?
Yes, it gives me personally. I have a strong sense of calm, knowing that these people will be handling our country's economy. Of course, let's take note. The reason why this is happening post COVID, COVID didn't help us. It shut down economies globally. But what's also happening is that, you have this shock that's happening in the Russia and Ukraine, bringing global inflation higher. So people have to react according to that.
Mm-hmm. We're looking at the honeymoon period of the Marcos administration, but he will be inheriting an elevated inflation, monetary tightening. Do you think the local market pricing is correctly in any risk of stagflation? We're actually scared of that term and of it happening here in the country.
Okay. Start off, maybe I would say not yet. Mm-hmm. Let's start with defining stagflation. Stagflation is associated with high inflation and stagnating economic activity, which in turn leads to an increase in unemployment. Although inflation in the Philippines has reached 5.4% year on year, it is still expected growth would trend upwards, maybe 5.7 upwards of the sixth level. This in turn would mitigate the impacts of inflation. However, the high inflation and higher prices will indeed impact the bottom line of many firms.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of higher prices, turning now to oil, which is one of the problematic things we're experiencing right now. Some analysts believe global crude prices will likely top $150 to a barrel. We're now, if I'm not mistaken, $123 a barrel right now. How real is that scenario of us hitting $150? And given that expectation, is it time to re-rate stocks and corporate earnings?
Okay. The forecast, if I'm not mistaken, was given by a Moody's analytics economist. Goldman Sachs, on the other hand, is calling for about $135, $140 per barrel. The consensus between the two of them, of course, is they see oil prices continuing to rise. I believe that their estimates take into consideration the current low oil inventories. But with the U.S. and OPEC planning to increase production, oil prices may be better managed. So hopefully there will be some increases, but not at the $140 level. Going to your second question, of course, the higher inflation and higher prices will impact the bottom line firms. From a PSE index viewpoint, initially I was thinking of about 8,000, 8,200 year end. A re-rating to 7,500 to 7,800 may be more likely at this point.
Mm-hmm. All right. Looking at what the local players would be thinking, how do you recommend asset allocation? How much should we be investing in fixed income or in bonds, in equities or in cash? Your thoughts on this, please.
Well, Rika, I always believe that it's up to the investor in terms of the risk palette. For investors with more conservative risk palettes, they can buy bonds and hold them to maturity if they can. The higher inflation leads to higher yields and thus higher coupons. For investors who have a more aggressive viewpoint, they can buy select stocks, which are obviously now at lower valuations. So generally, the ones in between would probably have 70% investments in bonds and the remaining balance of 30 to 40% in equities. Those would be the moderate investors.
Do you think we have to be wary now in investing instead of just putting money in different stocks?
We have to be very, very precise. We have to understand the risks being posed to each particular company. And of course, with the reopening, which companies would tend to, get most of the gains? My personal view is that the property sector with the continuing opening of the economy will further reap the gains.
Mm-hmm. Okay, for the rest of the week, Robert, we're looking at a lot, so many issues coming up. We have April industrial production numbers, April unemployment rate, and March FDIS. Do you see any reason for us to be optimistic?
Well, aside from those numbers, I think the reason for us to be optimistic is the further reopening of the economy. Mm-hmm. And we can expect more growth and hopefully lower future debt levels. And as I said earlier, there is optimism with regards to the strength and expertise of the incoming Philippine economic team.
Okay. Lastly, before I let you go, your advice for investors, at least for the rest of the week, what can they do?
I think right now they can see that there are opportunities in the market that's coming to them. Obviously, everybody is at the shock considering the high inflation levels. But there are, of course, ways that you can profit from this. as I said earlier, you know, buy a bond because yields will have not been as high compared to previous years. So if you buy a 5-year, you probably will get a much better yield that rather than buying it maybe a month ago or even a year ago. And of course, as mentioned earlier, if you are more aggressive, buying stocks at this point will probably get you more gains because of their lower current valuations.
Mm-hmm. All right. It's been enlightening talking to you, Robert. At least giving us hope, a little hope that we're not really on a bleak future for the moment. Thank you so much for your time and you have a good day.
Have a good day, Rica. Thank you.
Thank you from RCBC. We have Robert Ramos. Time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers. From Business World, the World Bank says the Philippines' debt is still manageable despite reaching the globally accepted sustainable threshold of 60%. But it cites the need for a solid fiscal consolidation plan and high economic growth. From Business Mirror, the information technology and business process management sector posted a 10.6% revenue growth in 2021. This brings its total earnings last year to $29.49 billion. And from the Wall Street Journal, streaming app Spotify is targeting 1 billion listeners by the end of the decade. CEO Daniel Ek defends the strategy to investors amid fears of limited opportunity for the platform. More news now. Retired political science professor Clarita Carlos is appointed by Philippine President-elect Marcos to be his national security advisor. Dr. Carlos was once the president of the National Defense College and previously acted as the government's consultant in peace talks with the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. Marcos also chose House Deputy Speaker Conrado Estrella III to lead the Agrarian Reform Department. The Abono Party List representative is the grandson of Conrado Estrella Sr., who once served as the Agrarian Reform Minister, the administration of the president-elect's father. Carlos and Estrella accepted the offer to join the incoming administration following a 2-hour meeting Wednesday at Marcos's headquarters in Mandaluyong City. Outgoing and incoming Philippine leaders greet the Filipino-Chinese community as they marked the 21st Filipino-Chinese Friendship Day. President-elect Marcos hailed what he noted as the great gains from the Philippines' relationship with China. He said he looks forward to more fruitful engagements in the two countries' friendship.
The centuries-old relationship and friendship of the Philippines and China has been and will continue to be of great mutual benefit to our people. From trade, arts, culture, athletics, to regional peace and stability, to the employment of opportunities for our people, and all the significantly generous efforts extended to us during the pandemic, the cooperative partnership of our two nations continued to reach new heights.
Vice President-elect Sara Duterte spoke in a recorded message in which she hoped to achieve new milestones for the Filipino-Chinese community. The celebration held via video conference also marked in advance the 124th anniversary of the Philippine independence. Outgoing Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte sent a reported greeting, saying the occasion should remind Filipinos how their forefathers fought for the freedom they enjoy today. Philippine Vice President-elect Sara Duterte claims she spent no personal funds in her election campaign. Duterte submitted her campaign expense report to the Election Commission, along with other candidates who complied with the June 8th deadline to declare their own campaign expenditures. RG Cruz filed this report.
Vice President-elect Sara Duterte spent over $200 million in her 2022 campaign. Her statement of contributions and expenditures filed Tuesday showed she spent $216 million 190,955.06, all funded from in-kind contributions from her party and other sources. She didn't receive any cash contributions. She also didn't spend a single centavo from her own pocket or from cash contributions. Senator Manny Pacquiao spent about $120 million in his presidential campaign, for which he placed third. He reported receiving over $56 million in contributions, but he spent over 62 million pesos from his own pocket. Manila Mayor Isko Moreno Dumagoso spent over 242 million in his presidential campaign. He only received 241.5 million in contributions. He spent over a million from his own pocket. Candidates and parties crammed into the COMELEC's campaign finance office Wednesday to beat the non-extendable deadline. The law mandates the filing of campaign finance disclosures 30 days after the election. But this COMELEC resolution gave winners 6 months. Their sito remains vacant till they have filed their SOSE, at least according to COMELEC Resolution 10505. The Omnibus Election Code says offices of candidates who fail to take their oath remain vacant unless it is not their fault. Aside from not being able to sit, they will also be fined.
For now, June 8 is the deadline for those who lost, but for those who won, meron silang konting palugit. Siyempre, you know, we understand why it would be difficult for them to meet the deadline. Natutuwa po kami at nagpapasalamat kami kay Secretary Anyo na pinaalalahanan niya yung mga local elected officials na under sa kanyang pangangasiwa, no? Under the DILG, that this is a requirement that they have to comply with.
Jimenez denies the COMELEC is restricting media access to the sources.
In fact, media is getting a lot of information. I don't know where that's coming from. No, naghihigpit sa media. When in fact, wala pang official announcement ang COMELEC, nire-report na sa media yung sose. So anong paghihigpit ang nagaganap?
RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine Agriculture Secretary William Dar says government needs 9 billion pesos to help prevent a surge in rice prices. He says the funds will be allocated to fertilizer subsidy to assist farmers this wet season planting and prevent a decline in produce. Dar earlier warned of a possible 6 peso increase in the price of rice if production isn't sustained. Dar meanwhile says policy change is needed to achieve the campaign promise of President-elect Bongbong Marcos of bringing down the price of rice to 20 pesos per kilo.
Ngayon po, yung agrarian reform law, 5 hectare lang ang land holding na pwedeng i-retain ng isang individual. But today, the average land holding for farmers all over the country is almost one hectare. Yeah. So very small land holding, that's a problem. And you have a growing population. We now are 110 million Filipinos. So we need to up in terms of the hectarage land holding for any Filipino to really have economies of scale. The better approach is to open up maybe 25 hectares that an individual, that a Filipino can hold.
And before we go, stay informed and up to date with the latest news. Watch for free on iWantTFC. You may download the app or visit www.iwanttfc.com. And that's it for the show. I am Rica Lazo. Thank you so much for watching. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Market Edge podcast, available on Spotify. You can also watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.